Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. But the question is asking here about the hadith of praying salat al-fajr in jama'ah and then remaining in dhikr until the sun has fully risen, and then he prays two rak'at or she prays two rak'at, and then they'll get their reward of hajj and umrah complete three times. Is that hadith sahih to start off with? Is this something that is legislated in the religion? And if so, does it mean that I have to stay in the same place? And what is dhikr here? Do I have to sit there remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, la ilaha illallah, wa akbar, reciting Quran, morning, evening, afkar, should I say? What should I be doing at that time period? And what if somebody comes and starts talking to me? What if I lose my wudu? All of these different questions, inshallah, we're going to try and look at from the different masail here. Now, the first thing, the hadith in Tirmidhi that the question was referring to, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, an authority, Anas bin Malik. Now, there's dispute as to whether this is authentic. I believe Sheikh al-Albani has said that the hadith is da'if, but others from the ulama have accepted it. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man salla al-ghada fi jama'ah, whoever prays salat al-fajr in jama'ah, in congregation, thumma qa'ada yathkuru Allah hatta tatlu' al-shams. He then remains sitting. This is what the question is asking. He remains sitting until the sun has fully risen. Thumma salla rak'atayn, then he prays two rak'at, at the time of duha, at the time of ishraq, then the person will get the reward. Kanat lahu ka ajri hajjin wa umrah. He will get the reward of hajj and umrah. In another version, he says, tam, complete. Like I said, this is a issue where the ulama have differed. At-Tabarani from the ulama of the Salaf has said that it's not as jayyid. Many from the ulama have said that the hadith is acceptable, and others have said that it is daif. Even if we were to say that it wasn't, we have other narrations which suggest that this was the practice of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam anyway. So whether they will get the reward of Hajj and Umrah or not, if we were to go for argument, say that the hadith is not sahih, then this is definitely the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Nasa'i, and this has been made sahih by Shaykh al-Albani. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray and lead people in Salat al-Fajr. Then he used to sit in his musalla, meaning the place where he prayed. He used to sit there. Hatta tatlu' al-shams, until the sun has fully risen. And he used to listen, فَيَتَحَدَّثْ أَصْحَابِ. He used to speak to his companions at that time. So now here, this teaches us the meaning of dhikr. Dhikr might not necessarily be, subhanAllah, alhamdulillah. Obviously, that's the best form of dhikr, reciting Quran and the dhikr that we are accustomed to. But this now answers the question. Dhikr is anything which reminds a person of the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the general form or definition of dhikr. So actions can be dhikr, statements can be dhikr, remembrances inside can be dhikr. You can look at the sun setting or the sun rising, you can look at the cloud that's above you and think, subhanAllah, that's dhikr. All of that is dhikr. So as long as a person is in that state of pondering and engaging with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in acts of worship, seeking ilm is dhikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls this knowledge dhikr. Fas'alu ahla dhikr, ask the people of remembrance, meaning ask the people of ilm. So he used to sit with his companions talking. Now here, I mean, we don't want to get into too many masail and digress, but here the ulama, the majority of the ulama, have said that you are allowed to speak about dunya affairs in the masjid, as long as it's not disturbing people and it doesn't involve anything which is haram. And I think we've talked about this before. The Hanafis and the Malikis are strict on this. They say, no, it's not allowed to talk in the masjid. And from this discussion, you have various other discussions. Are we allowed to have Eid celebrations in the masjid? Are you allowed to greet with one another on the day of Eid? Are you allowed to have any kind of worldly discussion, even if it's going to be of benefit? Are you allowed to have seminars and games and youth conference which are not religiously orientated? So there is a difference. But here, the Messenger of Allah, this hadith in Sunan al-Nasa'i, he used to speak to his companions, يَذْكُرُونَ حَدِيثُ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. And in another version, they used to talk about jahiliyyah. In another version, they used to talk about shi'r and poetry. And the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَتَبَسَّمْ. He used to sit there watching them, smiling, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is proof to say that a person should and can remain behind in the masjid, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Salat al-Fajr, even if we were to say the hadith of Hajj and Umrah complete is weak, according to what Sheikh al-Albani says. But here, the Messenger of Allah used to sit in his place after Salat al-Fajr. Also, we have another hadith, and this is in Bukhari Muslim. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the person who goes for Salat, he is already in the state of Salat, and the Malaika are supplicating for him, Allahumma ighfir lahu warhamhu, hatta yansarif, until he finishes with his Salat. Aw yuhdith, or yuhdith, and we're going to talk about yuhdith in a second. Yuhdith, okay, let's talk about it now. Yuhdith can refer to talking, yani hadith, tahdith, or yuhdith meaning he loses his wudu, yani haditha and tahara. This hadith in Sahih Muslim, I think I said Bukhari Muslim, this hadith in Muslim authority, Abu Huraira, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying here, if a person goes to the masjid, he is in the state of salah, and the malaika, the angels are supplicating for him, Allah maghfir lahu, Allah marhamhu, Allah forgive him, Allah have mercy on him, until he leaves the place of salat. So now he's finished the salah, as long as he is there, they continue making dua for him. So now this is also general advice, as well as us receiving the specific advice that we've just seen. General advice, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying here, stay in your place of masallah, stay in your place of salat, and the angels will continue supplicating for you. Right. Aisha radiallahu anha, she said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all situations. كان يذكر الله في كل أحيانه. And this is in Sahih Muslim. He used to remember Allah in all of his situations, whether he had wudu, whether he didn't have wudu. So the question is asking here, okay, so now I know that I'm staying behind. Do I need to have wudu? In the first hadith, remember we just talked about the hadith just now from Abu Hurairah in Sahih Muslim. As long as he doesn't lose his wudu, yeah? This hadith now teaches us that a person can remain in the state of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even if he doesn't have wudu. However, it's better for him to have wudu. So we're going to talk about, will that cut off this i'tikaf? Because the majority of the ulama have said that you can make temporary i'tikaf. I'm very sorry, because we're talking about so many different things now when the answer was just supposed to be straightforward. Anyway, you can make temporary i'tikaf. You can go to the masjid and intend to be in the masjid for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. And this is i'tikaf that a person can do all year round. It's not just in Ramadan. And this is the majority of the ulama. And the proof of this, that Umar radiallahu anh said to the Messenger of Allah, I want you to make i'tikaf outside of Ramadan for one day, one night, not for 10. And the Messenger of Allah said, oh, from Madrik, fulfill your oath. So you can have i'tikaf whenever and however the duration, right? So this person is in i'tikaf after Salat al-Fajr until the sun has risen. He loses his wudu. The ulama have mentioned, the Messenger of Allah himself, and this is an example that we find in the Sunnah, he was, akramakumullah, he was in the bathroom. Obviously, at that time, they didn't have cubicles or fixed rooms. There was like a barrier between him and the person that was passing by. And the person gave salam to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whilst he didn't have wudu. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not respond. He then performed tayammum, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he responded. So they asked him, Ya Rasul, why didn't you respond? And he said, I do not like to remember Allah except that I am in a state of tahara. With this, the ulama have said, it is a form and a means of your dua and your dhikr to be accepted if you make dua and dhikr whilst in the state of tahara. So now, ma lam yuhdith in the hadith of Muslim, that is crucial here, because we now know after Salat al-Fajr he remains behind. He engages in dhikr. We've talked about what dhikr is. We've talked about the origin in the Sharia, that this has a place in the Sharia, that a person can do this act of worship. But what does it mean, ma lam yuhdith, as long as he doesn't make any hadith? I mean, as long as he doesn't make hadith. What does hadith mean? Here, as long as he doesn't lose his wudu, is one interpretation. So if you are in the masjid, you pray Salat al-Fajr and you want to stay until sunrise, and then you've lost your wudu, then this reward now has been cut off. However, the ulama have mentioned, now many from the ulama have said, this is difficulty. Who can control his bowels? Who can control what's happening? Therefore, they have said, the ulama, and this is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we seek, if a person loses wudu, he goes and performs wudu, and he comes back and he continues, and he will still get the same reward. Hajj complete, and Umrah complete. And we're talking about ما لم يحدث also can refer to speaking. Imam Nawawi in his book of Adhkar, he says, imagine now you are in this mode, you are in this, you know, focus and concentration of worshipping Allah, but then a person comes and speaks to you, he gives you salam, or he sneezes and he says, you have to say Yahamukullah, or it's a person you haven't seen for a long time, or whatever, any kind of conversation that a person wants to have with you, does that cut off this act of worship? He says, no, alhamdulillah. But what you must do is return back to the situation and the state that you want to be in. Meaning, you excuse yourself, or you speed up the conversation, or you answer the person, you know, swiftly, and then that's it. You return back to remembering Allah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He places khair and goodness in all of us, and in this clip as well. I think hopefully we've answered the brother's question. He's saying, can I stay in the masjid remembering Allah until Salat al-Fajr and get that reward? Inshallah, yes. Even if the hadith is weak of Hajj and Umrah, then it's definitely something that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to practice. It's something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by in the Quran with Duha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by that time. Therefore, praying that Salat al-Duha is something which is legislated. As for what is dhikr, we talked about anything which engages a person in the remembrance of Allah, whether that's ilm or reciting the Quran or listening to hadith or listening to a lecture or reading a book or just making any kind of dhikr of Allah. As for a person losing his wudu, then he can continue in that state of remembering Allah. It would be better for him to go make wudu and come back. Or if a person is cut off and, you know, has to have a conversation with someone, again, you can have that brief conversation and then continue in that state until the sun is firmly in the sky, like the distance of a spear. Pray to Ruka'at, inshallah, there is a great deal of reward for all of those who accomplish this act of worship. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He grants us all tawfiq and success, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us of those people who are connected to the houses of Allah, so that He will shade us underneath His arsh. On the day there is no shade except His. Hada, wallahu a'lam, sallallahu ala nabina.